Thank you for the invitation. I tried to tell you something about our local initiative in Hersbruck to preserve what rests of the local concentration camp. You see the picture, the concentration camp in Hersbruck existed from July 1944 to April 1945. You have a look at some of the barracks, and you have the same. You had the same picture just before. Can you help me? I wanted to tell you that Ljubiša Letić was a Serbian prisoner from the 3rd of December 1944 until his liberation by the US Army on April the 20th in 1945. Ljubiša was one of the prisoners who had to work out the tunnels with a drilling hammer. It was by the excessive noise that he lost part of his ability to hear. That's the way he told us afterwards. Go on. If you go to the area of the former concentration camp in Hersbruck, you wouldn't be able to find anything remaining from 1944 or 1945. You see, the town of Hersbruck and the public opinion tried to forget what kind of an accident had happened. Years ago, there was no intention at all to write a page about Nazi concentration camp into the book of history of Hersbruck. Today, you'll find a huge finance office dominating the place, parkings, a playground for tennis, and houses, a complete settlement. Only the roads let you estimate the extension of the area. Please go on. Two memorials at places where the Nazis had burned dead bodies open air, outdoor, one near to a village called Schupf, and another one, the next one, near to the village of Hubmersberg. They were erected in the 1950s already. Those were the first places of commemoration in the surroundings of Hersbruck. But nearly anything else happened then for a long time until the years of 1982 and 1983. Hans Friedrich Lenz, a German minister of the Lutheran Church, wrote a book about what had happened in the Hersbruck camp. As a member of the SS, he had been the writer of the camp, Schreiber, and he had preserved notices from life and death inside the camp. A student, I think about 18 years old, of the local secondary school, Gerd Wanseloff, wrote in 1983 a paper about the camp and finally published it. He had to face a big opposition, but slowly public interest began. The first memorial place near to the place of the camp was a huge stone with the inscription, "Who doesn't remember the past is condemned to live all through again." It was dedicated in 1983 to the victims, but you can see it is also aimed at the inhabitants of Hersbruck. It was dedicated by the youth organization of the German Trade Union Federation, Deutscher Gewerkschaftsbund. Years passed again. In 1999, there was the idea a registered non-profit association would be good to carry remembrance into the public. That was the date of foundation of this e.V. of the association. It would be easier to collect money, easier to combine different ideas, easier to get along with politicians and inhabitants of the town. The name was Dokumentationsstätte KZ Hersbruck e.V., Documentation Site Concentration Camp Hersbruck e.V. The main aims were documentation, what rested, remembrance, prevention, contact with victims, and making public. The aim was to erect a memorial or a museum. Our association didn't achieve in doing that, but others did. In the year 2000, a new version of a film produced in 1992 already, KZ Hersbruck and the Dockerwerk, was presented to the public. And in August 2001, the association got rooms and an archive in a part of the old town wall called Wildzirkelturm. The rooms are without hire to the owner, the town of Hersbruck, but the association provides the daily costs for energy, water, telephone, communication, and so on. This is the picture of the place. The idea of a documentation center got quite a lot of public consent. Next picture, please. The main task of our association is to celebrate the annual commemoration in Hersbruck on January the 27th with a Christian service by all the churches of the town together in a local old church, a silent march on the footpath of the prisoners from camp to labor, and a commemoration act at the sculpture by the Italian artist Vittore Bocchetta. Next one. Since 2010, the association organizes a chain of candles along the daily footpath of the prisoners, provided by students and their families from five schools in Hersbruck and Habburg at the International Day of Commemoration on January the 27th. Next one. Gerhard Faul, an active of the association, printed a complete description of every detail of the camp, still today the main publication about the camp and life and death in the camp. And a mobile exhibition was created and presented and meanwhile explained in many places in the region. Next one. The French Association des Déportés et Familles des Disparus du Camp de Concentration de Flossenbürg et Commando visited for several years Hersbruck on their way to Flossenbürg. Members of our association kept contact, translated, did everything around it. Next one. In 2007, the sculpture Ohne Namen 1944 bis 45 without names was erected in the park besides the camp area by the town of Hersbruck and her former mayor, Wolfgang Plattmeier. The artist is well known worldwide, Vittore Bocchetta from Verona. He had been a prisoner in the camp himself and survived. I used the word prisoner, now I learned that you take the word inmate.
Whatever you want.
He is still alive and he will be 100 years old in November this year. We still have contact to him. Next one. In 2009, seven info panels have been erected by the Memorial of Flossenbürg, five of them in the camp area, two of them in front of the entrance F to the Dockerstollen. Now it is possible to read at least main parts of history on one's own as a visitor or on guided tours which provide voluntary members of the association. You see two of those panels. Now the next one. In 2007, the member of our association, Peter Schön, met Lubiša Letić for the first time in Flossenbürg. You see also one of the drilling hammers. This was the beginning of a personal friendship and a friendship between Lubiša and many people in Hersbruck. In 2010, it was the first time that Lubiša came back to the place of his suffering. We invited him to come back again and again and go into the schools and tell pupils and students about his experiences. In the middle, you see Lubischa. 16. In one school, he was welcomed with an exhibition with paintings and texts to the whole life of Lubischa. The pupils had studied before. Lubischa's message was short. Trust in God, he will help you. You don't need very much for life. The worst thing is war. Never make war again. Never let people suffer. And his words found their way to the hearts of pupils and students of each age. They became friends and still remember today. Next one. He was a really good ambassador of goodwill for a Serbia within the European Union. This is a picture with our mayor, with the mayor of Hersbruck, Robert Ilk. Next one. In January 2012, he was part of a human chain, 1,100 students around the former camp area, Lubischa among them. Each student had a plate with the name of one victim. This was a big commemoration event for Hersbruck. And in the same evening, we had discussion with inhabitants who had already lived in 1944. So you can say from one side to the other side of the former fence of the campground. The same year in autumn, my wife and me, we visited him in Novi Sad. We went to Lok, to his birthplace, and he showed us the house where he has been born. And we got into the church where the bad and sad story of his father's death is like presence in a painting at the wall. It was really important for him that there was somebody who listened to the story of his life, who was really interested in it. His telling was like a healing process to him. One thing he missed extremely was that almost nobody at home in his own country had time or interest for the story of his life. At home, he had to let pass by time sitting in front of his new home, an old people's home, or even worse, in bed in a three-bedroom. You see him, the fourth from the left. Next one. His visits in Germany, Hersbruck, were like holidays for him amongst friends, and people were open for his message. I don't grudge. Let us live together in harmony in a peaceful Europe. I was able to go to Novi Sad when he had died and tell his relatives at his burial about his relations to Germany. And we have lost a good friend in 2014. Rest in peace. Next one. In 2016, two documentation sites have been opened by the Bavarian Memorial Foundation from Munich. You only see this picture. This belongs to the other one you saw just before. Now you can find profound information about the camp and the victims if you visit the camp area in Hersbruck or the place of forced labor in Habburg. Thank you for listening. The last picture shows you the small booklet we made about Lubischa Letic, and he signed them on his own. I have some books of them with his own name here in this place.
Yeah, thank you very much. So I hope we have at least 10 to 15 minutes to for your questions and the final discussion, and I would like to ask you to join us because you can guide us to the final discussion. It's your project, so maybe you have an interest to focus the discussion in a certain direction. But now for your questions to our presentation. Yeah, thank you.
I have a question to Mr. Lensch. Which is rather a personal question, because I have a son who's in ninth grade, and his class is just confronting the fact that there are some pupils in the class who kind of take pleasure in provoking some Nazi speeches, etc. And the question is it just puberty, or do they have some sort of conscience of knowing what they're doing? And this sounds very fascinating and very worthwhile, and it's excellent that it's happening. But while I mean, it seemed so much connected to the presence of this testimony that, and then in the end you have the documentation center, but it made me wonder now, how do you go on in teaching the pupils? I mean, the pupils that you showed have now finished school and are going elsewhere.
Yeah, it's great.
Now there are this next generation. What do you do now when there are no testimonies? And how do you do it? How do you make kids come and be aware of what happened, etc.? How does the story continue now that we should let teach and come and talk to them? Because I think this is the most impressive way of teaching kids what it means.
Yeah, the first thing I want to say, I think it's the best to keep in contact with some person. And that's what we are still trying. That's why we keep contact to Vittorio Bocchetta, because he's the last one we can contact to talk to him. And our students and pupils, they would like to fly to him in November, but we need a whole aeroplane for that. It's impossible. The other question is really difficult, because we do not really know how to go on. One of the ways is to have the films and videos about the persons and about when we met them. And we would like to do more about this, because this is a way to reach the students and pupils instead of having a living person. The other one is documentations like those booklets, what these people told us. Our experience was that pupils bought this booklet and they read it within one night and were really interested. But what else there will be? This is the big question. And we do not know even yet. He arrived in, I noticed the date, on 3rd of December 1944.
Yeah.
Not in Flossenbürg, but he arrived in Hersbruck.
Yeah. Flossenbürg, it was November 15th.
Okay. Mm-hmm. It was within 2 weeks.
From which area? From Hungary? From Komarno. From Komarno?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I think. Look, a lot of it is, of course, Hungarian occupied area. Mm-hmm. They are from those areas. And a lot of Serbs were forced to work on different parts of Hungary. They were recruited, but they were not soldiers. They were forced labor, mm-hmm. in fact. Mm. On the front to dig trenches and so on. And this is the way how forced labor in Hungary were connected with forced labor in Germany. Mm. But it was after German entrance to Hungary, as it was March 1944. But in fact, some way connected. And this is the example of this connection. This is my comment.
If I may,
if
there are no questions or comments, I would just like to point out a mistake that I noticed. Your database, which actually opens an important methodological question. There was one guy on your list where you have nationality, country, and name, I think, right? So stood Rijeka, Serbia. Rijeka is actually in Croatia. So, but nowadays, but in the times of the Second World War, it was Italy. Mm. So you have a problem. What do you write? Italy, Yugoslavia, Croatia. Only, so you think about it.
That's exactly the point we want to improve. During the tutorial 1 month ago, we had also a think tank GeoData, where there were 7 experts from different universities, from Trier and from Graz and from Barcelona, which are very skilled in all these problems of toponyms and topographic and historical maps. And their task was to think about how to deal with this problem of locations, especially in documents and databases, because you have strings, you can match it in Google Maps, but it always depends on the time which you are talking about, and it's changing in different time spans. And they want to implement now, or create a process, which in the end should have as a result the implementation of a system which can exactly deal with this problem, that you can have a possibility not only to deal with every single string which you can pull out from a document, but which also could enable you to deal with some regions in a polygon structure, so that every location which is inside automatically can have a right administration overhead and relation to nation or occupation thing. So we are working on that, but that's really a huge topic, and I think we will need some years to go on. At the moment we have for every geolocation 3 or even 4 fields, string and Google and historical map, and I forgot the first one. So we are aware of this problem. This thing of Serbia, Rijeka Serbia, depends which student or scientist pulled out the interpretation from the documents.
Yeah, and
what we had in mind.
There is also the problem of place names. Rijeka is Fiume in Italian, and many people around the world know it as Fiume, and not as Rijeka, and so on and so on. Not to mention places in the Vojvodina, we have Serbian, Hungarian, Slovak, sometimes Romanian or German name. Parallels of
states. Many places also with the Rijeka or river in their name, from Rijeka Crne, which is
but
others. But, so you can always get multiple stream results. What we have actually tried to do in our little mapping projects, we had the second. We are here on the second one actually on the Paramus in Belgrade and Kragujevac. We are going to have to implement actually 2 maps with each result for each person from the database. The current Google map and the street maps of the period of the map, most probably based on the 1939 map. So the same locations can actually be used by 2 mapping modules. One will have to load the current map and the other one the historical. So that's a possible solution.
Yeah.
If they don't sit on the same server, there is not much of the way to move. For the site itself. Also, when it comes to the correction, cross correction of the street names, for example, the street Splitska next to Tabosa Sugar Camp, for example, it has been shifted in Belgrade since. It's not going to appear on the same location
for
for the present map.
Yeah.
It's going to move from just across on the Alte Kommande all the way to the Ostenische Street, almost. About 3-4 bus stops away.
Yeah.
If that's connected to Spritzka, then you have, you're not only moving the events, the street has run away.
Yeah.
That's kind of an issue. Can make an issue with those systems. But this has been an
education.
I didn't notice among the data for each person. You have place of birth, place of residence, and but is there a place of from which they was he was sent to the camp?
If we already reconstructed the transport, then you will see it in the example of Lubija Letic. In the top line, there was a data set of the transport from Komarom. So, but this is also a huge work to do, because we have thousands of transport lists and thousands of information about transports in the prisoner register. But to reconstruct the transports, you can do it partly automatically, but it's also a huge huge work which you have to do by manually work. And we are very happy that we could launch a new project, which is funded by the Free State of Bavaria, which is dealing with Polish prisoners. It's a 2-year project about Polish prisoners' transports into the Bavarian concentration camps of Dachau and Flossenbürg, together with Dachau Memorial and the State Museum of Auschwitz-Birkenau. And actually next month there will start a new staff member in Flossenbürg, and there also will be one in Dachau and one additional in Auschwitz, which will deal exactly with this reconstruction of transports, which is for sure an advantage for not only for clarifying fates of Polish prisoners, because the transports from Poland had also other prisoners, and most of the transport were mixed prisoner nationalities and categories. But for us, it's a very good advantage, because the whole thing with this memorial archives database will be put on a broader basis. So actually, in the moment, we are starting phase two, you can say, from after these 5 years of developing the Flossenbürg tool, with improving structures and developing means which are also useful for other memorials, and we are offering that for other memorials to host their data in there or to give comments and their know-how. Now we are really working with 3 institutions for 2 years in the system, and there's also a new perspective about which is dealing with a huge amount of Soviet POW files, which are coming from the from the Deutsche Dienststelle, which is the former Wehrmacht Auskunftsstelle, WAST, in Berlin, which is soon part of the federal archives, and where there was already a 15 years project made by Dresden, and now is a second project which is done by Volksbund Deutsche Kriegsgräberfürsorge and the German Historical Institute in Moscow, and they also are eager to work out their data in the memorial archives, because they did not find any other platform, which is such a research platform where you can have so many possibilities to modify your data and to make queries and link it to other data from concentration camps and everything. So we are at the moment in a very comfortable position, and could hope that this work about reconstructing transports and adding more detailed data and more correct data to every single prisoner file is now in the hands of much more people than before in the last years. So we think it will grow now quite rapidly.